It is showtime.
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good morning, everybody. That was the incredible KC and the Sunshine Band. Very, very, very big group a little while back. In fact, a little while before you were born, probably. This is Dr. Minarcik, and today is Thursday. It's April 11th. We are in Chicago. It's 9 o'clock in the morning. And this is our 59th session in free global online medical school pathology. That's why I have that big 59 on your screen there, and a little sticker that I got from my daughter's sticker book. So good morning. How about if we close my ugly face and get down to business, sort of? I guess The first question on your exam here is, do you hear me, and do you hear me well? And I'm seeing a bunch of yeses. I'll pull down the question box so I can see a string of them. Second question is the video test. What do you see on your screen? Aha, well, you got the general idea. Actually, I'm going to pronounce the name of this building. It's currently the tallest building in the world. I hope that I pronounce it properly. If any of you know how to pronounce this properly, just let me know if I'm saying it correctly. I call this the Burj Dubai. It's the tallest building in the world, and it will be until somebody in Saudi Arabia builds the Kingdom Tower, which will be a lot bigger. When I was a kid, we were always told the Empire State Building was the tallest building in the world, and now it's the ninth tallest building in the world. Okay, I guess we could get into business and close up our little control panel here. I'm happy today because I'm looking at the light at the end of the tunnel. We only have two chapters left. They are relatively short chapters. They are chapters that classically do not have lab because of the topics in them. There may be a little lab, but I think characteristically I don't have labs on these last two chapters. We're going back to general pathology now, and you don't have to feel that you missed anything in general pathology in order for you to understand systemic pathology, because these two chapters are kind of independent of your basic knowledge of pathologic processes. One of them is written by my friend Dr. Vinay Kumai. It's called Environmental Nutritional, and that's what we'll be starting today. Maybe do it in two sessions. Last session is in pediatric pathology. I want to tell you something about the chapter today, so let's pop it up over here. We have always had in every medical school pathology course since the beginning of time discussions of things like exposures and trauma and toxicity and drugs. And you know, it's kind of like a hodgepodge. I don't want to use that word because that makes it sound bad, but it's a lot of little things, much of which we've already discussed and alluded to. Now we're looking at them from a different angle because we have this whole big concept of environmental now. You know, we are all environmentally conscious. All of the people are saying we have global warming, but here it is, April 11th, and it's still freezing every morning in Chicago, so I'm not too sure if all of that stuff is entirely true. So this is a combination pathology of topics of environmental and nutritional. Generally speaking, we're going to be talking about environmental exposures, and that concept of exposure is going to extend into things like drugs and trauma, you know, not just, you know, ozone and you know, heavy metals and stuff like that. So we'll be talking about diseases caused by things that are in our body and don't belong there, and maybe we have a hard time handling. We'll also talk about basically a few items in nutritional pathology. That's basically the opposite. That I'll be talking about things that we don't have in our body and we should. And vitamins is the best example. Now, probably the greatest exception to that rule is the concept of obesity, which we're not going to deal with. Obesity would be an example of a nutritional disease due to too much of something rather than not enough of something. So these are the concepts we'll be talking about. We might as well start out by saying that the environment is a rough place. You know, we've done a lot of things during our civilization process to remove harmful things. Oh, not just things like pollutants and stuff like that, but things like radiation and trauma. And we're going to really expand that concept of exposures. We'll probably divide them into the classical environmental exposures and some of the things which get now into politics a little bit, occupational exposures, because in this country where I live, the United States, in many countries, a lot of these occupational exposure diseases are reimbursable, and they often are act as a springboard for many lawsuits as well. And then we'll say nutrition and disease. There'll be a few things we'll talk about, just notably a few common worldwide vitamin deficiencies which may affect us. The thing I want to say is there is no way in the world in a couple of common sessions, which I feel are appropriate for medical students, could we discuss all these topics. Any one of the things that we talk about is encyclopedic. And a lot of it is packed with political stuff as well. And once you get into politics, you know, medicine and facts don't mean anything anymore, because there is a massive amount of disinformation and misinformation spent about the role of a lot of these things. And one day you'll hear that substance A is the greatest thing in the world for you. A competing company will publish another scientific paper saying it's the worst. So we're not going to get into that. But what we will get into now in occupational diseases are the common ones. And without going into all of them specifically, but touching on them, without a doubt, the single biggest reason for reporting an occupational disease in the United States, you know, these are OSHA statistics, the Office of Safety and Occupational something or other. Of the, let's say, 500,000 reported occupational diseases, you know, maybe 60, 70, 80% of those are repeated traumas in the workplace. Another thing, the second biggest category by far are skin disorders. So if you add all of those up, you got over, oh, maybe 350 out of 430,000. But take a look at some of these other things. We talked about lung diseases and all of the common pneumoconiosis. So the lung is a favorite site for disease injury simply because it's the entry for a lot of toxins. Physical injuries, not nearly as common as repeated traumatic episodes. Poisonings, lung disease due to dust, and even though this is now at the bottom of the list, the very smallest one, you're not going to be driving down an expressway in the United States and see a lawyer's picture saying, have you had exposure to physical injury or poisoning or skin disorders? You know, there'll be things like mesothelioma lawyers. You know, you see them on TV and on the internet all the time. So all of these have a big, big, important role in the concept of occupational diseases. But remember, trauma and skin conditions, chiefly due to being exposed to allergens in the workplace, are by far the two biggest categories. I do not intend for this chapter or this course to be in any way a replacement for your common solid knowledge of pharmacology, and I hope this is considered to be very, very easy stuff for you. Let's say you have a substance, we'll call it a toxic substance, and of course, as you know, toxicity is always related to dosage. So you have the concept of what amount of dosage of that so-called toxic substance, or substance that should not be in your body, that is harmful to your body in many ways, can produce an effect. And that's called the threshold effect. Would be a minimum amount. And that threshold effect may be different for different people. So when they talk about threshold effects, they're often talking about a percentage of people that show some type of observable effect due to the entrance of the toxin. I guess there's only three ways to absorb materials, and that's by either through the mouth, through the lungs, or in the skin. I can't think of any other way. If anybody has any other ideas, let me know. So these are the portals of entry of different toxins. And of course, once they are in the body, they are then distributed, they are detoxified, they are metabolized. Hopefully, they are metabolized in such a way that they are more able to be excreted. And some of them have a hard time. We're going to talk about some of the chemical things going on there. And of course, you cannot neglect the toxic effects. Perhaps the short-term effects are easy to see. They're characteristically classical for the toxin. Some of them may not be apparent for many, many, many years. Some of them can only be theorized in terms of a toxic effect or a mutagenic effect or a carcinogenic effect. So let's talk about how these toxins, And I guess a better name for them would be xenobiotic. Xenobiotic is the buzzword. A xenobiotic is a substance. It's a chemical. And it's found in your body. And it's not supposed to be there. It's something from the outside. But nevertheless, it gets in through one of these three routes. Your body then has a couple different ways of how it handles them, okay? The classical description of how the body handles xenobiotics is in terms of either phase one or phase two. The classical phase one reaction performed, you know, in your smooth endoplasmic reticulum, if you remember that, what that does, it basically oxidizes the toxin, okay? In the process of oxidizing it, you know, adding an oxygen or subtracting two hydrogens, you know, there is a family of enzymes called monooxygenases, and the phase one results in an adding of an oxygen, ultimately either through a flavin-containing monooxygenase or a cytochrome P450-dependent monooxygenase, or peroxidase, you know, a super oxygen molecule coming in. And phase one reactions are typically adding an oxygen. Once you add oxygen to a xenobiotic, you make it less lipophilic. You make it more polar, okay? Another way to make it less polar or less lipophilic or more nonpolar is to add another molecule onto it. That's perhaps even a little smarter. And of course, that's the function of, you know, liver, for example. You know that bilirubin gets the addition of a glucuronide to make it more soluble, to make it more metabolizable, to make it more excretable. Another common method is biomethylation, okay, to add methyl groups. Another thing is to conjugate it with various glutathione compounds. So in every case of having a toxin or a xenobiotic in your body, you're making it less fat soluble, more water soluble, more polar, more adaptable for excretion by various methods, whether it's renal or hepatic. And remember, the monooxygenases are basically the ones that are doing the phase one and the phase two. I've read, sometimes you see in the book, you know, phase three reactions as well. They're not quite as common. But I think the phase three is more of a concept, is that the phase three would be once these xenobiotics are made more adaptable for excretion, well, then they're finally excreted. So a lot of times I'll talk about phase three as the final excretion stage. Okay, I normally don't like these big charts with a million arrows, but this one I like. It's very, very appropriate, and it's very similar to what we just talked about, and it's a concept without going into the fancy biochemistry. Here's your exposure to a compound that is potentially harmful. It's certainly not part of your body, and it shouldn't be part of your body. You got the three portals of entry, mouth, lungs, and skin, okay? It has entered. It's now distributed in the body. Now, this compound is then metabolized. We talked about phase one, phase two. Here's one for conjugation, which is phase two. Here might be a mechanism with the monooxygenases to make them less toxic, less lipophilic, less likely to enter the cells. Theoretically, the body could even change that toxin to make it even more toxic. If you remember when we talked a long time ago, before we went to Puerto Rico, about carcinogens, we said some carcinogens, or what we call initiators, aren't carcinogens in themselves, but after they're metabolized in the body, they become more carcinogenic. So if they're not metabolized for excretion, they are distributed, okay, in the process of being distributed in the cell. They can have interaction with DNA, with proteins, with RNA, with various receptors. This damages the cell. The cell can then die. You know, it can be replaced, hopefully. And the long-term effects are basically genetic effects, you know, carcinogenic effects, reproductive effects, whether they're mutagenic or teratogenic, or general injury on the body's ability to defend itself from disease, or immunotoxic. This is a good way of looking at the big picture, and it doesn't require a lot of memorization of chemical equations. I thought I'd throw in here something that looks a little bit busy, and I normally don't like to have lists like this, and is not intended to be memorized, but I think you should have a familiarity with the common compounds. If you were to go to your neighborhood toxic waste dump, okay, and there's a bunch of those, and you were to ask for the list of things that they generally store, this is probably the bulk of what's in most of them. They're generally industrial compounds that cannot be changed easily. They have to be stored. They have perhaps some horrible effects if coming in contact with the body. They are carcinogens, they're teratogens, they're mutagens. They are toxic, destructive compounds. I kind of noticed as a observation here that, you know, A, B, and C are only the first three letters of a 26-letter alphabet, but they comprise half of the compounds that you would see in a toxic waste dump. Acetone, aldrins, okay, things that are used in industry, in insecticides, barium, heavy metals, benzenes, butanones, cadmium, carbon tet, chlordane, chloroform, chromium cyanide, all things which could be extremely harmful, toxic to the human body. So I guess even though these are alphabetical, you could kind of group them into, you know, heavy metals, industrial chemicals that cannot be changed in any way easily to make them less toxic, and they're out there being stored. And, you know, our government has a whole set of very, very big rules as how they should be stored and make sure they don't leak, and they're tested regularly, you know, and these places can be closed down if they don't pass their test, just like everything seems to be testing now. You know, you're not even taking this course to learn medicine. You're taking this course to pass a test. Everything is test. Here's the dose response curve that we talked about. In many respects, it would mimic to what we see like in radiation survival. You basically have on this side a cumulative response. The percent of people or subjects or rats or humans that showed some type of observable response. And of course, at the very low portions, there could be a small amount of material in which there's no response. But once there is a response that's regarded as a threshold, this could be different for different people. So that's why it's often expressed as a percentage. For example, at the 50% level, that means 50% of the subjects would show some kind of response. And of course, then the more of concentrated or the greater the dose you have, the more people or subjects or rats responding, up until the point that no matter how much you give, there's not much more of a change. So that's why they'll talk about the 50% cumulative response rate. It's also similar to what in radiation what we call the LD50-60, or the number of subjects or people that would die at 60 days. There's also a time limit on these things as well, based on the amount of toxic substance that they receive. And don't forget, radiation is an exposure too, you know. Here are the common exposures. These are, I believe, from robins. We're not going to talk about all of them. We're going to touch on the salient important points of some of them. They are not necessarily mutually exclusive. You know, the personal exposures, you know, the two big ones, tobacco and alcohol, we'll spend a lot of time on. We're not going to talk about all medications. We're going to talk about the common medications many people take and their short and long-term effects. There's just a few of them. We'll say some things about outdoor and indoor air pollution. You know, now that energy and fuel is a lot more expensive, people are insulating their homes better. So there is not much progress being made in indoor air pollution with people insulating their homes better. Yeah, cold air can't get in, but things can't get out either, you know, like radon, for example. We'll mention probably just to have you have a familiarity with some of the common industrial exposures, agricultural hazards, and so on and so forth. We're going to say a good amount on radiation and physical injury as well. I doubt if we'll be able to do all of that. But I want you to remember that an exposure has a broadened, widened definition. It's not just exposure to things in the air or things in the soil or, you know, things at the workplace. It's even things like medications, you know, not just harmful drugs, but, you know, drugs that people take every day medically. We're not going to be talking about the side effects of all drugs. Things like radiation will be considered an exposure. Even physical injury, lacerations, contusions, these are all considered or defined, at least by OSHA, as exposures. And it's a good way to think about them, too. So let's talk about, at the top of the list now, the number one biggest killing common personal exposure. And I think you know what that is. That's tobacco. You know, I don't want to sound like a preacher here, and I don't want to sound like I'm just, you know, horribly, you know, passing judgment, but, you know, without a doubt, tobacco is, you know, by far the most preventable cause of death in the United States. The two biggest killers that your patients and you will die of are either going to be neoplasms or cardiovascular disease, and they have a massive causative effect in both of them. They cause cancer. We all know they cause 70% of the lung cancers. They cause probably 30% of the non-lung cancers in almost a direct way. They destroy blood vessels. You know, when your uncle goes in for a cardiac bypass and they say, why, how did I get this way? They're going to say, well, smoking is the big thing. Genetics is the second big thing. Horrible effect on lung diseases. We talked about some tobacco or smoking specific respiratory diseases like DIP, but many of the chronic lung diseases, chronic bronchitis, the fibrosing lung diseases. A smoker can be regarded as a person who is destroying his lungs capability, immune capability. And of course, don't just think of cardiovascular, think of the cerebrovascular diseases, strokes, okay? Take a look at this number, and I think it's nice to remember that the effect, the cost in health-related costs, at least in this country, per year, $150 billion. And by the way, that's about the same as alcohol as well, but that's another story. So remember, tobacco, single most preventable cause of death in the United States. We said it causes all the lung cancers, 30% of all cancers. You know, often the question is asked, well, we know that the tires and the irritants cause chronic bronchitis, and we know that the there's a whole bunch of aromatic amines in the lung that will be our direct carcinogens. But that's generally for the non-small cell. In other words, the squamous, the adeno, the large cell. Does smoking also cause or related statistically to the small cells as well? And the answer is absolutely yes. In fact, many of the studies have shown that there is a stronger relationship between small cell and lung cancer than non-small cell and related to tobacco. And another thing that is often missed is, you know, when you hear somebody has lung cancer, the first thing you say is, did they smoke? But when somebody gets a renal cancer, that's usually not the first question that comes to your mind. There is a large number of non-pulmonary cancers. You know, I use renal as the most classic example, but we're going to see examples of this and all over the body as well. okay, let's say you go to a party and, you know, you're a really smart person and you want to remember some of these specific compounds. You know, I don't remember them. I know some of the acronyms here. But, you know, in the cancers of both the lower and upper respiratory tract, you know, the squamous cancers, the general carcinogens are the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, the things that have a lot of cyclic or benzene rings. The big specific compound that's in a lot of the literature is often just called NNK, and that stands for 4-methylnitrosamino-1-3-pyridyl-1-butanone. Okay, let's just, that's why it's called NNK. Polonium, a radioactive isotope, you know, is also in cigarette smoke as well. In the present in the tobacco smoke, the tars are causative agents for other cancers as well. In the esophagus, NNN for N-prime nitroso nor nicotinic acid has been a direct carcinogenic link. Also, for the pancreas, that same NNK that's causing the lung cancer has a direct effect on pancreas as well, perhaps not as strong. Bladder cancers, you know, bladder cancers are very, very strongly related to cigarette smoking as well. Not just renal cancers, but lower urinary tract cancers. And of course, we all know what happens to the people that want to be like baseball players, and they start chewing the tobacco and spitting it out. And these are things that are people that are taking chaw and snuff. The same compounds, of course, would be more likely to cause a cancer in the oral cavity if they're not inhaled. You know, further proof. These compounds are it. So remember, NNN, NNK, polonium. You know, these are the big, big, big baddies in tar. It's the nicotine that gets you hooked, but it's the tar that gets you cancer. Okay. What about some other staggering statistics now? You know, you're not intended to memorize this. You might look at some of the bigger, bolder, redder numbers here. Let's say that your risk of getting coronary heart disease, if you're under 65, is 1. Okay, your number 1 is the number that's your average risk. Well, if you're a smoker and you're a man or a woman, you're 3 times more likely to have coronary heart disease. If you're over 65, it's a little bit less, okay, about half as much. What about stroke? What about cerebrovascular lesions? The same sort of thing, isn't it? So what does that tell you is that the effect of smoking for blood vessels, whether they're in the heart or whether they're in the brain, is 3 to 4 times much more for people under 65 and about half as much for people over 65. Look, if there was no such thing as cigarette smoke, all these things would be ones, wouldn't they? And don't forget, related, let's not just talk about the smaller lesions. Let's talk about aortic aneurysms. Take a look at this. If you're a male and you don't smoke, your chance of getting an aortic aneurysm is 1. If you do smoke, it's 6.2. If you're a woman, it's even a little bit bigger. And of course, this one is really the one that blows me away. We're into the double digits now. If you don't smoke, your overall chance for chronic airways obstruction, let's call it emphysema or chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, for lack of a better word, is 10 times greater than if you don't smoke. And it's even worse for women. And look at some of these things. Look at the cancers of the upper respiratory tract, the pharynx, the oral cavity. We're into the double digits there. And for some reason, it's a lot more in men than women. And even the ENT docs will tell you that, you know, I don't know, maybe it's because maybe more men are likely to chew tobacco than women. I don't know. But almost seems like all of their cancers of the upper respiratory tract are in people that are smokers and or drinkers. If you go to the ENT doctor and you say, when's the last time you did surgery for a cancer of the upper respiratory tract and the person wasn't a smoker or a drinker, they'll say they probably can't remember. Cancer of the esophagus, 7 or 8 times as likely. Stomach, not too bad. It's only about twice as much. But look at lung, both small cell as well as non-small cell. If you're a man and you smoke, you have 23 times as more likely to get a lung cancer than if you don't smoke. And that's twice as much as a woman. But a woman is still 12 times as likely. Okay, so on and so forth. There's even little things like cervix and kidney, 3 times as much. Bladder, 3 times as much. So the thing that you have to really, really understand, and you probably do already, is smoking doesn't just cause lung cancer. It has a massive increase in risk to all these other organs as well. Radon, often the concept of radon, you know, people that have radon levels, you can get a radon detector. Radon has a link to lung cancer as well. But you want to know something? Whatever that link is, it's much, much, much stronger if the person's a smoker. They talk about the synergy, okay? In other words, radon has a certain risk, smoking has a certain risk, but radon and smoking together has more than just their combined risk. It's a synergistic effect. We talked about the tar causing bronchitis, asthma, pneumoconiosis. I guess you consider cigarette smoke a form of dust, personal exposure, much in the same way, silica, coal, grain dust. So if you're in a person that is a potential candidate for a pneumoconiosis, okay, you have a certain risk. Well, that risk is multiplied several fold if you're a smoker. So you take all of these people with these various occupations that have died of these pneumoconioses, it's much more likely that they smoked than they didn't smoke. I'm done, ranting about cigarette smoke, you know. I heard something on one of my YouTube movies today. Is like it was not a nice little clip from our former attorney general, but basically he said, a few generations ago, it was considered very stylish and cool to smoke, you know, with your high school friends and, you know, in the men's room. And nowadays, when people smoke, you know, they walk outside and they hide, you know, behind cars and garbage cans. It's almost like it's a crime. So probably one of the biggest things that is now being attacked is brainwashing or attitudes. You know, if you think of most high school students now, they don't think so much as they did a couple of generations ago that it's so cool to smoke. Okay, let's talk about the second biggest thing, which has about the same impact. We're talking, you know, over $100 billion in the United States, economic loss a year, and that's alcohol. And if you look at the statistics, and I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, what is an alcoholic? Well, we'll get into that a little bit. But 15 to 20 million alcoholics in the USA, by anybody's definition, that means a very rough estimate, 1 in 10. You know what? I guess you could talk about 100,000 deaths due to alcohol abuse, not just cirrhosis, but other effects. That's not quite as high as the tobacco. Tobacco was 4 times as higher. I have to ask you a question right now that's critically important, so I'm taking out the window here. I want to ask you a question. Out of these 15 to 20 million people that we have so-called defined as alcoholics, how many of those 15 to 20 million people know that they are alcoholics? That's the most crucially important question. The answer is none. None of them do. That's the main definition of alcoholism, is denial, okay? We also talk about defining alcoholism, which is crazy in terms of how much you drink, you know, and it's not a clear-cut definition, especially to the alcoholic who doesn't know that he is. But I would say most people, if you want to go by quantity of alcohol, you know, the amount of alcohol in one beer is about the same as in one glass of wine, which is about the same as one shot of hard liquor. So that's a drink, okay? So let me ask you another question. Of all the people in the world, or in the United States, or in your country, that drink more than two drinks per day, how many of those would be regarded as alcoholics by whatever definition we want to call it? Yeah, I'd say, so everybody's saying all. I think that's pretty close. I think that's the amount. It could be less, it could be more, but, you know, with all of the arguments, if you go into a bar in the United States and you walk in and you see, you know, 20 people there, and they're there regularly, there's not a party, okay, they're probably mostly alcoholics, okay? And none of those people would ever think they are alcoholics, but they've been having two or three drinks at that bar every day for 20 years, so I don't care what their level of denial is, they're alcoholics. A lot of times when you go to the medical conferences, or you read some of the literature, you'll say, well, there's this study in France that showed that, you know, a little bit of alcohol has a protective effect on your LDL, cardioprotective. You know what? I have to use a bad word here. In fact, I want to use two bad words. One of them is really bad, and the other one is just bad. When you go to a medical conference and they talk about a so-called protective effect of alcohol, I want two words to come to your mind. Fucking bullshit, okay? The only thing that two drinks or a little bit every day has ever done is lead to three or four. And everything over two is alcoholism. Now, I will admit something here. I know this is the first time I've ever admitted this, you know, online, and I guess it's recordable. There was a lot of alcoholism in my family, okay, when I grew up, and my brothers and sisters had to suffer through it. And remember, if one out of every 10 people is an alcoholic, and an average alcoholic has, oh, let's say 3, 4, 5, 8 people that are intimately close to that person, that alcoholism is going to affect the lives of those non-alcoholics. It could affect it so they become just as sick as the alcoholic. And that's why people go into Al-Anon. I was in Al-Anon for 12 years. I guess I'm still in Al-Anon because I still realize in my life I have suffered from the effects of heavy alcoholism in the family. When you hear a couple of alcoholics fighting with each other, often the greatest topic of fighting is, I'm not an alcoholic, you're an alcoholic, you know? And so, in other words, let's just make this very simple. If you want to know my definition, you know, you may violently disagree with it if you're a regular drinker, but if you have at least two drinks about every day and you don't think you're an alcoholic, and if you're vehement that you're not an alcoholic, then that would be my definition of an alcoholic. Okay, let's move on. Let's look at some of the effects of alcoholism in terms of quantities on things that we call impairment and stuff. And even relate those into number of drinks. And remember, we defined a drink as one beer or one glass of wine, you know, 6 ounce glass of wine or 12 ounces of beer, or one shot of hard liquor, you know, mixed or not mixed. Here's your blood level. And in medicine, The usual units for measuring blood level are milligrams of alcohol per deciliter of blood. You know, there's other things you could say. You could say plasma rather than blood, but let's just say 20 milligrams of alcohol, ETOH, ethyl alcohol, per deciliter, one-tenth of a liter, in your body, could be only one drink or maybe two, you'll feel, you know, pretty good. You'll have a little bit decreased inhibitions. Maybe you'll be laughing more, you know. Maybe you'll be telling some dirty jokes. I don't know. Whatever you do at parties. At the level of about four times as much, you're probably going to have what they call some potential cognitive or motor impairment. Now, I want you to remember this number of all the numbers as well, because this 80 in terms of milligrams per deciliter in the medical literature corresponds to the 0.8 that the police use when they stop you from driving. So 80 milligrams per deciliter in your blood of alcohol corresponds to what they call a BAC, or blood alcohol content or blood alcohol concentration, of 0.8%. So the difference between the medical literature and the police literature is the same number. It's just three decimal points. So an 80 milligrams per DL would correspond to this number on your breathalyzer. Okay, it's just a matter of three decimal points. There's a couple of other minor factors involved, but let's keep it simple. At 200 or 10 times as much, you're going to have severe problems, poor judgment. You know, you might even fall down. Okay, these are the falling down drunks. Once you're much above 200, a little bit more, 50% more, you could actually be slipping into a coma. And if a falling down drunk has about twice as much, he's probably at risk for death. These are general numbers. Okay, there's a lot of variations, and we'll talk about those variations. But let's talk about first what happens when that 80 or 20 or 200 is in your blood, whether you talk about it as BAC or milligrams per DL. Most of it gets metabolized in the cytosol. A good fraction, about 20%, goes in your microsomes. But the bottom line is, whether it goes through the cytosol or the microsomes, it's going to be oxidized. Now, if you remember from your basic biochem, OH, which is alcohol, gets oxidized to aldehydes by addition of oxygen. And in the case of the microsomes, that main enzyme is a P450 oxidase, okay? In the cytosol, it's alcohol dehydrogenase. So taking away two hydrogens or dehydrogenating alcohol gives it additional is like adding an oxygen. Bottom line is, you now have this intermediate compound, acetaldehyde, okay? It's oxidized alcohol, basic biochem 101. And then this stuff gets oxidized even further by another oxidization process. Just like this was alcohol dehydrogenase, now we have aldehyde dehydrogenase in the mitochondria, metabolize it even more to acetic acid, okay? So that's basically your metabolism of ethanol, basic chemistry. Now, what does all this mean in your body and in terms of practical drinking? You know, you're right now thinking, or maybe you know, how many drinks you have to be legally drunk. I guess that's really the key question, isn't it? Well, that totally depends on your body weight. Because if you weigh 120 pounds, you only need half as much to be legally drunk than somebody that weighs 240 pounds. So let's say that we take this 0.8 here, which in almost all of the states, I think it's all of the states of the United States and maybe some other countries, once that BAC is 0.8 for percentage, okay, blood alcohol, this is the thing the breathalyzer spits out, or here it is here, here it is here. Once you're beyond that little blue zone, you are legally drunk, you're in big, big trouble if they nail you. Now, if you are 120 pounds, you know, between two and three drinks can put you there. If you're twice as much, 240, it might take four or five drinks. That's just simple, basic math. And then you might say, okay, I've had my two or three or four drinks. How long do I have to wait for me to come back down into the passing zone so where I don't flunk the breathalyzer? And I'll give you a little estimate for that now as well. It's for every hour you wait, you probably subtract one drink. That's very, very, very crude mathematics, but that's probably right. So if you're thinking at the borderline zone, wait for an hour, and you'll pass the test. Now, once again, you know, passing the test, like in medicine, it's not the end-all, be-all of your existence, but it will keep you out of big trouble. So the number that you must remember, United States, legal intoxication, you get locked up, you lose your license, you spend thousands of dollars of fees, 0.08% of blood alcohol concentration. Now, I've been using a lot of generalities here, and I want to get into a little bit more of the mathematics. This is the one that they use in court when the expert witnesses come in and they try to determine whether the validity of some of these tests. Don't be spooked by these numbers. This is called the Widmark equation, okay? And it means all of the things that we've already talked about. In other words, the concentration, that's C, that's the end point. Let's make it really, really big. The concentration of alcohol in your blood is dependent on how much you drank, okay? That's A. That's the mass of ingested alcohol. Okay, and there's other factors like the density of alcohol is not quite the same as the density of water. It's only 0.8%. But it's divided by your body weight. Those are the three biggest numbers. Okay, but then there's a little thing there called R as well, and that's like a little constant. And you have to remember, it's a little bit different for females than it is for males, so you have to take that into consideration as well. Another thing that you should take in consideration is that that concentration is then eliminated by zero order kinetics. In other words, once you reach a certain level, that alcohol is then degraded or metabolized or gotten rid of in your blood at a constant rate. And even though we have a number here that looks like it's about 1/5 per hour, that's approximately equal to what we said of one drink per hour. And you know, this Widmark equation can get a lot fancier and talking about other things like elimination. These are all little factors in the Widmark equation. But let's make it simple. The amount of blood in your alcohol, depending on how much you drink and what your weight is and whether you're a man or a woman, and then the amount that that degrades or lessens over time is this number here, okay? It's also known as a beta in the Widmark equation, but let's call it one drink per hour. That's not just for you, but for your patients. We are involved in a little case right now where somebody was involved in a fatal accident. He passed the breathalyzer test. Then the police came to his house a couple hours later, and they wanted to do something fancier. You know, the parents agreed, oh, yeah, let's have the police take you to the hospital. Aren't they nice? Well, at the hospital, they wound up taking the blood again. He was still legally not drunk, but they extrapolated the data to the time of accident, and now they're saying that he was drunk, and he's being charged with murder. Okay, this is very, very sticky legally. The medical, the physiological, the aspects are very, very clean. The legal aspects are very, very, very dirty. because you're going to bring in one expert that says he was drunk, and you're going to bring another expert also from a prestigious Ivy League institution that says he wasn't drunk. There's a lot of overlap here when we talked about liver before, but I want you to think of the effect of alcohol on the liver as being a spectrum. And it's a very simple logical spectrum. We're going to show you in the next slide the some of the biochemical mechanisms and several different reasons why fat accumulates in the liver with chronic drinking. If you are an alcoholic, you have fat in your liver. It's probably also enlarged. It may also result in some mild elevation of enzymes. So remember when we talked about fatty change, we also called it steatosis, whether it was macrosteatosis or microsteatosis. We also called it fatty metamorphosis. It's fat in the liver with no evidence of inflammation or necrosis. Okay, it could be a lot of fat. Your liver could be 50% fat and quantitatively and still just have fatty change. About 10 to 15% of those will go to not only a lot of fat in the liver, but now inflammation of the liver, secondary to the fat. That's called alcohol hepatitis. It has a lot of classical features, the most classical one of which is something called a Mallory body. But another classical feature is the fact that to differentiate it from viral hepatitis, all of the liver experts will tell you that the main difference pathologically between alcoholic hepatitis and viral hepatitis is fat. Generally speaking, viral hepatitis does not have abundant fat. Alcoholic hepatitis does because it comes from fatty change. Now, if you take that 10 or 15% rule for the alcoholic hepatitis from fatty change, take about 10 or 15% of those now as going on to cirrhosis. So sometimes it's been as high as 25%. But let's just say it's a healthy fraction. Now, whatever those percentages are, whatever the statistics are, okay, that could be debated. The thing that is not debated is that if drinking is stopped at this level or at this level, the chances of cirrhosis are very, very small. Okay, so I don't know. It's not a case of the patient cognitively knowing it, because the definition of alcoholism or any other addictive illness is that they have no control. So cognitive medical information doesn't mean a damn thing. Why is there fat to begin with? Because that's the mother of all liver disease, isn't it? The fatty change, the alcoholic hepatitis, eventually the cirrhosis. Well, one reason is that alcohol increases the breakdown, the catabolism of fat in peripheral tissues, in regular fatty tissue. And that breakdown then results in increased delivery of free fatty acids to the liver. Well, you bring free fatty acids to the liver, and that means you're bringing in the material for it to make more fat. Another thing is that alcohol, there is basically a excess in NADH biochemically over NAD. And once you have that delicate balance tipped over to where there's more ADH, you're generally pushing the a tendency for lipid biosynthesis. Another thing that alcohol does is it decreases fatty acid oxidation. So if you're decreasing fatty acid oxidation in the mitochondria, that means you're decreasing the amount of fat that normally would be broken down in the liver. Another thing that has been observed in the literature is that there's this protein called tubulin, and this intermediate compound, acetaldehyde, it screws up your tubulin and impairs your function of your microtubules. Therefore, this decreases the transport of lipoproteins from the liver. So these are four biochemical reasons why fat forms in the liver. Okay, here's the really good picture, and this is the picture where I'm going to ask you a question. Oh, I think you all know this is a liver by now, and I think you all know that most of those washed out spaces are fat. So here's my question to you. Let's say the normal weight of a liver is 1,500 grams, okay? Let's say that this liver is enlarged. Well, let's say it's, 2,000, maybe more, maybe 25 or 3. So you have hepatomegaly and you see a lot of fat. Now, let's say that you put that fat into a big chemical machine and you just wanted to measure the amount of fat quantitatively. You extract it. So what percentage of the weight of this liver is fat? Give me your answer. You're saying 80, 60, 50. I would have said about 50 or 60 myself. But that's just a little exercise to show you that, fatty liver involves the whole liver. So if this is a representative slice or sampling, which it is, you could almost quantitate the amount of fat in this liver. I guess what you could also do is just take your image sampling program and count the number of white pixels versus pink pixels, and you'll probably see that there's about, for every pink pixel, there's probably one or two white pixels. So it's over 50%. Here's something a little more detail. And we said this again in liver, but we'll say it again. If you have a big fat space, like most of these are, and they are considerably bigger than your average hepatocyte, here's four hepatocytes. Here's a couple big spaces. They're all bigger than hepatocytes. That's called macro, because it's big. That's called macrovesicular fat. What would you call these little fat spaces that are within the cells and smaller than the hepatocytes, like you see seven or eight of them over here? That's micro. Okay, folks, so here's the question. What do you think is milder, micro or macro? Right, you got that right. Now let me ask you this. In every case of macro, do you still think you see some micro? Yes or no? Now, in every case of micro, do you think you see macro? Probably not. If it's primarily macro, it's not as bad, but it will get there. Okay, let me show you a couple more pictures. Maybe we'll take our break then. This is also a lot of fat in the liver. But do you see these inflammatory cells? Chiefly mononuclear, lymphocytes. There's still a lot of fat. You don't really imagine that there's a lot of fibrosis here, but what is that red body there? And what is that red body there? It's very eosinophilic. It's within the cytoplasm of the hepatocyte. What about that red body there? There's a lot of them. This is what they call Mallory bodies. It's also called alcoholic hyalin. Now I'm going to use a word that I'm fascinated with. It's called ubiquinated. I don't think I ever heard the word in my life, ubiquinated. It's down here, unless it's in, probably a biochemical word. And what it means is that the intermediate keratin filaments of the hepatocytes are now bound to other proteins, which cause them to be ubiquinated. Now, there's a ubiquinated proteins, and one of them is called the family of heat shock proteins. There's another one called P62. But you all know this is a liver. You all know it has inflammatory cells. You see Mallory bodies. And Mallory bodies are fairly diagnostic of alcoholic hepatitis. But what's another reason that that this is not viral hepatitis, that there's a lot of fat? Yeah, you can have viral hepatitis in a fatty liver, but generally, most viral hepatitis does not contain a significant amount of fat. If I know that my boss, Jim Liu, who is a big liver pathologist, I don't think he would disagree with me on that one. Now, here we got another liver, and once again, you see the two things here that are classic for cirrhosis. Number one, you see loss of the normal hexagonal portal architecture. And you see nodules here and here and here and here and here. They're irregular in size, and they're separated by bands of fibrous tissue, which completely encircle them. So those are the two features for classical cirrhosis. Number one, nodules. Number two, fibrosis between the nodules. But the big thing is loss of the normal hexagonal portal architecture. Also, remember, if you have loss of your normal hexagonal portal architecture and you don't have a good relationship now between central veins and portal veins, another rule of thumb is that if you have even just a small amount of liver in a biopsy and you don't see any central veins, but you see fibrosis, chances are it's cirrhosis. And if these nodules here are so small you can only see them with a microscope or a good magnifying glass, that's called micronodular. If they're actually so big you could feel them when you slice the liver with your gloves, that's called macronodular. Okay, I think we're done. You know what? We're already way past the hour. There are going to be a couple more things I'm going to say about alcohol in terms of other effects, but we'll save that for after the break, and I think we're progressing at a pretty nice pace here. So I got some really nice music lined up for you. And see you in 10 minutes, and rock on until then.
Got to Mr. Roboto Domo. Take fame. Don't need no credit card. because there are stars above you. You never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. God only knows what I'd be without you. If you should ever leave me, oh, life would still go on, believe me. The world could show nothing to me. So what good would living do me? God only knows what I'd be without you.
Beautiful songs. Just to remind you, one of the songs we listened to was called Power of Love, and the other one was called God Only Knows. Actually, before these songs even started, there were two words that came to my mind during the break, possibly something I forgot to tell you or something that's worth saying again. I'm going to put up a piece of paper here. And you can see, here's the first word that came to my mind. Can you see the word? If you can see the word in red, please type it out. It's the word control. So you're seeing it very nicely. I think you also saw Woofy during the break as well. One of the probably most accurate definitions of alcoholism is loss of control. I know that's a very common word, but alcoholics feel they can control everything, including their alcoholism, which they don't even admit to. The best definition of an alcoholic would be an insane person who keeps trying to control things that he knows he can't control. Not just the alcohol, but alcoholics are basically pretty controlling people in their life as well. In the 12 years I spent in Al-Anon, the thing that might come to your mind now is, if a person is out of control, how do you control the disease? Ah, that's the question, isn't it? So how do people handle alcoholism? Well, you know, the pharmacy companies would love to tell you they got a drug that does it, you know, because they think they can, and you know, they'll lie to you, anything. The people that are alcoholics and are recovered, they're back in control, have realized one thing, that because they no longer have the power to control themselves, they have to admit there's a higher power. This is the 12-step program. This is Al-Anon Bible, okay? So this higher power, a lot of people call God. You know, I'm not giving a sermon here, and I don't want to bring religion into this thing, but most alcoholics will tell you that they were totally out of control, and the only way they could put their life back in control is to realize there's a higher power. Now, this may not be strange talk to most of you, because if we said that 10% of everybody in your country is an alcoholic, and they have an average of 5 to 6 close people in their life, I don't think I've ever met a person in my life that has not had some kind of very bad effect in their life due to a close person that had drug addiction or alcohol. So the higher power is God, and the last song was God Only Knows. We're done with the religious lesson. Let's go back to pathology. Say a few more things about alcoholism and its effects. You know, we talked a lot about liver, but what about other systems? You know, the chief and most serious effect of alcoholism on the central nervous system actually goes by two names, and often they're put together if you consider them part of a spectrum. Sometimes they'll say, the usual term now is Wernicke-Korsakoff, okay? And basically, Wernicke is mild and Korsakoff is worse. I would like to say Wernicke is worse because they're both, but it's not. Korsakoff is worse. So in Wernicke syndrome, which are more severe but part of the spectrum for Korsakoff, you have things like general confusion, ataxia. What does ataxia mean? Well, it means cerebellum. They can often get double vision or problems with their muscles of the eye. People that have Wernicke syndrome, generally chronic alcoholics, basically chronic alcoholics with acute binges. You know, very often this is an admission diagnosis into the hospital. You can actually see pathologic changes in their brain. The most likely places to see those pathologic changes are in part of the brain that you know are called the mammillary bodies. And we know that if ataxia is a big part, you see pathologic changes in the cerebellum, hemorrhages, and all these areas, including, if you remember the aqueduct, that little narrow canal connecting the third to the fourth ventricle, also called the aqueduct of Sylvius, okay? Cerebral aqueduct is the best term. Usually there's damages in the gray matter surrounding that as well. That's in the midbrain. We're going to show you a nice picture of it. Now here's the big difference. Most of the changes, the clinical changes, okay, if there's a lot of pathologic hemorrhagic discretion, it may not respond. But the milder forms of the Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, the left end of the spectrum, is very likely to respond very well to thiamine deficiency, because most of these changes, most of these toxic changes, are not due to the direct toxicity of alcohol, but often due to the fact that the alcoholic has not been having enough thiamine. So if you've been in an emergency room or up on the wards yet and alcoholics comes in, which it seems like half of your patients will be after a while, the first thing they do is they put them on heavy doses of thiamine. They might come in with DTs, okay? And they may respond very, very nicely to prompt thiamine replacement. Now, in the more severe forms, you know, something called Korsakoff syndrome, you may have all of these changes of Wernicke's. You may have all of these pathologic changes as well in the mammillary bodies and the surrounding the cerebral aqueduct. They can get complete, they could be completely out of it with confabulation, totally confused, memory loss, and they are more likely to have their damage not just due to thiamine deficiency, but also a direct toxicity. And not only is it much more difficult to treat, and not only may they not respond well to thiamine, but they may die. Okay, this is a very, very serious syndrome. I think I have a picture here. And to keep this in mind, because this is a good picture, if you remember, this is a nice slice through the midbrain. If you remember, that little hole right there is your cerebral aqueduct. Well, take a look at those hemorrhages, okay, surrounding it. They're inferior and lateral. Those are pathologic changes. You know, that's a classical finding in Wernicke-Korsakoff. Now, here we are near the base of the brain here, and you got your mammillary bodies. Remember your mammary mammary bodies are the other end of your hippocampal system, you know, forming that big system. Okay, mammillary bodies. You can remember they do a lot of things. Here's some same type of hemorrhages there as well. Now, I don't think that thiamine in itself are going to make these hemorrhages go away, but they often improve the patients clinically. The more severe the hemorrhagic pathologic changes are in these areas, the less likely they are to respond completely. And finally, we talked a lot about liver. There's nothing more to say. We talked about the nervous system, Wernicke-Korsakoff. We talked about ataxia as being a big part of that, and the cerebellar damage is chiefly nutritional, okay? And the people can get neuropathies, chronic alcoholics, okay? Those can frequently be helped by thiamine. So neuropathy and alcoholic, thiamine is one of your big first lines of therapy. There is can be a direct toxic effect on cardiac muscle fibers. You know, alcoholic cardiomyopathy we spoke of before. Okay, you also know that the alcohol clinically has a vasopressor effect. So hypertension goes hand in hand with alcohol abuse as well. Here's a couple more things on the list. People that are alcoholics, they get pancreatitis. You know, somebody comes into hospital with pancreatitis, acute or maybe history of chronic, you're thinking they're probably alcoholics. You know, gastritis, number one cause, alcohol. People can get direct damage not only to their striated cardiac muscle, but their striated skeletal muscle, resulting in rhabdomyolysis. These are all toxic effects now. These are not going to be cured by thiamine. And in terms of a fetus and pregnancy, you know, if you look at your can of Budweiser that you see in front of you, there's probably going to be some warning about birth defects, increased spontaneous abortions. Okay, and this big topic of babies that are born to alcoholic mothers with so-called fetal alcohol syndrome, having severe problems in central nervous system, increased chance of teratogens, birth defects, and a growth retardation as well. So these are generally the long laundry list of things now that we are completely finished with talking about alcohol. Let's talk about therapeutic drugs. And this is the part that is kind of like I don't like, because there's only four here that Robbins has decided to focus in on, and I guess I'll have to go along with them. There's probably about a million more that should be on the list. And of course, everything you subscribe is going to have a laundry list of side effects if you read the package insert. But many, many people, probably number one, number two most common over-the-counter drugs, your NSAIDs, your aspirin, your Tylenol are on the list. Probably the two biggest non-prescription drugs in any drugstore. Many, many women taking birth control pills and hormone replacement therapy. And when they go on them, they have certain questions, and you have to know how to answer those questions honestly. So let's go to birth control pills, one of the most widely used drugs in the world. The first question the woman's going to ask is, does it increase breast cancer? Because it's an estrogen, isn't it? Estrogen is a promoter. It's a hyperplastic agent. It's a growth agent for breast lobules. The answer is no. Most of the, I would say, generally speaking, the birth control pills that are used now show no evidence in breast cancer. Now, here's something that's funny. They have a pretty good, strong statistical relationship with cervical cancer, but it doesn't mean that estrogen is hyperplasing the squamous cells. You know, estrogen hyperplases glandular breast cells. Probably a woman with birth control pills is going to be doing a lot more, I'm trying to think of the proper way of saying this. If you're on birth control pills, you're probably a lot more active sexually. So people that are more active sexually have an increase in cervical cancer. The one thing that birth control pills have been a link to is clotting. Woman on birth control pills is at a definite but not massively high risk for deep vein thrombosis and therefore pulmonary embolism. Also, people, women that have coagulation problems, the most notorious of which is the factor V deficiency, you know, the birth control pill is going to enhance the coagulation problems due to a factor V deficiency. And I guess if you put a woman on birth control pills and she has factor V and she has bleeding problems, you're probably going to be sued. Okay. Cardiovascular disease. Generally speaking, we always said that estrogens have a cardioprotective effect on women. And that's why women don't generally peak in their MIs until about, you know, until they after they reach menopause. So atherosclerosis is not increased in non-smoking women less than 45 years. There is a increase of stroke, however, not hemorrhagic stroke, but ischemic stroke. So what are the two or three things that you should warn them about? Number one, they have an increase for chance for clotting. Number two, they're slightly increased rate for stroke, no matter what their age is. And when we went to the liver chapter, we talked about the so-called benign hepatic adenomas. Okay, sometimes they're called focal nodular hyperplasia, but they're benign nodules in the liver. They can look like cirrhosis. These are also linked very, very strongly to women that have taken birth control pills for a long time as well. So those are the three things that you want to make sure your patients are aware of that you're going to put on birth control pills. What about the older, slightly older group that wants to take estrogens as well with some combined progesterone as hormone replacement therapy? Okay, they want to delay menopause. They want to reduce the psychological and physical things. Well, they're going to ask you, is this possibly going to increase the risk of breast cancer? And the answer is, yeah, there is a statistical increase. And specifically, people that are long-term HRT, they have increased risks of breast cancer. You know, they didn't for birth control pills, but they do for HRT. And of course, if they take their progestin with estrogen, the so-called combined therapy, okay, it generally has a very, very low risk of endometrial cancer. But once again, thromboembolic, just like the estrogens from the birth control pills, we got a big, we have an increased risk. Up here, it's twofold, okay? I don't know if that's as big as something like, you know, cigarette smoking, but it's definitely twice as much. Another thing to remember is that even though we said that estrogens in general have a cardioprotective effect, the Women's Health Initiative, you know, branch of the NIH, did a big study. It showed that there's actually about a 29-30% increased risk of myocardial infarction, especially during the first year of combined use. Go figure. I can't figure that one out, but those are the statistics. So, person that wants to go on HRT, you have to tell her there is some increased risk of breast cancer, that there's, like the with the birth control pills, there's an increased chance, twofold, you know, of thromboembolic events. And I guess if you don't tell her this and she has a heart attack, you know, you'll probably be sued by some slick lawyer who advertises widely on the billboards along your highway. What about probably one of the most widely prescribed non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents, you know, Tylenol, acetaminophen? There are so many people, look at the statistics, that are on Tylenol, perhaps higher doses, perhaps long-term, that have hepatic necrosis. Now, if Tylenol is over-the-counter, there's not much you could do to control that. But if you know your patient's on Tylenol, you prescribe it, you know, absolutely, during that time, you should be checking liver enzymes. You know, it's not like aspirin. It's a little bit different kind of a thing. It doesn't affect the cyclooxygenases if you go into that side of the equation, which we'll do. It doesn't really have an anti-inflammatory effect. but it has strong actions for reducing fever and pain as well. So this hepatic necrosis, as you would guess, is dose-related. It's also time-related. And it's probably the number one things. Well, here's a recommendation that should be reduced in children with fever, especially dehydration and fever. So be careful with Tylenol. Just because it's over-the-counter, you may have no control over it. That doesn't mean it couldn't. Probably when you go to a pediatric conference or any conference and they talk about the differential diagnosis of hepatic necrosis, you know, Tylenol is probably as high on the list as anything. Here's a liver here. I'm going to make this a little bit bigger. And do you remember when we talked about liver, we said that one of the main general rules of thumb with liver is that if the liver is exposed to ischemic changes, like, for example, in congestive heart failure, it's a flow or oxygen problem. The center portion of the lobule, here's a center portion of the lobule. Here's some portal areas. There's a portal area. These are be more likely to become necrotic. We said that central lobular necrosis is the general rule for oxygen or flow problems, and that a toxic problem would be a little bit more likely to be periportal. Well, unfortunately, this is the exception to the rule, because in this case, we have a toxic substance, acetaminophen, and even though the first area that comes exposed to by both the portal and the arterial circulation is periportal, it shows a classical pattern of central lobular necrosis. I hate to show classical things that are exceptions to the rule, but that's one of them. What about the big thing now, aspirin? You know, there's a lot of people on aspirin. You know, believe it or not, even though the drug companies send their salesmen to your office and they talk about cyclooxygenase-specific compounds and how they're 10 times more than a regular old aspirin, people are still using regular old aspirin. And, of course, regular old aspirin inhibits both cyclooxygenase 1 and 2. And 2 is nice because that results in all of the beneficial effects of aspirin. But 1 is bad because that results in platelets problems, okay? Cyclooxygenase 1 inhibition is bad because it results in platelets not sticking to each other. So before we get into that, remember, there's still a lot of people. When I practiced medicine for a while in the Army Reserve, there's still a lot of those recruits that are, you know, overdosing on aspirin. It might sound like a terrible thing, but people that are taking large doses, something doesn't work, so they take more and more and more. And sometimes intentional suicides. Those patients are going to have a respiratory alkalosis because of hyperventilation at first, but as the toxic effect gets greater, it's actually going to be a metabolic acidosis. And the more severe that metabolic acidosis is, the more likely it is to be fatal. A much more likely form of aspirin toxicity, much more common, is the chronic toxicity. Patients taking larger doses, longer amount of time. The buzzword for chronic aspirin toxicity, which will be on your test, will be tinnitus or ringing in the ears. But even remember, things like headache and dizziness are in there. They're a little less specific. But tinnitus, I called it tinnitus. Some people might call it tinnitus, is a classical buzzword for chronic salicylate toxicity, also called salicylism. Okay, many, many people die every year because they're taking too much aspirin. Most of those are unintentional. Most of those people have chronic pain, and they're taking over-the-counter stuff, and all of a sudden they'll have massive GI bleeding. Okay, take a look at the statistics. There's a lot of them. The major cause for that bleeding is the fact that aspirin also interferes with cyclooxygenase 1. And that's the reason for making specific sorts of aspirins that are specific just for 2. There's a syndrome in kids called RISE syndrome, R-E-Y-E, It's classically for generations been linked with children taking aspirin as well. Rye syndrome, if you want to remember it quickly, is basically two things. It's fatty liver and it's encephalopathy. Those are the two. That's the CCPP for Rye syndrome. And kids that were taking it with viral infections like chicken pox or flu, kids, I mean like under 15, had a very strong statistical relationship between aspirin and Rye syndrome. We got to open up the topic now a little bit for the so-called Cox inhibition, although, you know, your drug salesman will be glad to take you out to dinner and, you know, take you for a conference in Jamaica during the winter and tell you all about it, as long as you prescribe their Cox-specific inhibitor drugs, you know, which cost, you know, $4 a pill, you know, rather than aspirin, which is about one penny a pill. And, of course, that difference is what pays for your meal over at the resort in Jamaica. But cyclooxygenase 1 inhibition is bad because cyclooxygenase 1 is the thing that keeps platelets working. So if you inhibit it, you interfere with the stickiness, with the aggregation, with the adhesive properties of platelets. It's also involved in the gastroprotective aspect as well. So if you have a situation in which you're inhibiting your COX-1 and you lose your gastric mucosal protectiveness, and in addition, you are inhibiting your platelets, that's really the main reason for people dying from long-term aspirin exposure, okay? Cyclooxygenase 2 inhibition is good. This is the one you want it to be. It's basically the things that have all the good effects of aspirin as an anti-inflammatory agent, antipyretic, anti-inflammatory. And, of course, this is the main thing that is the anti-inflammatory agent, if you want to think of about it. So I think I'm going to show you something now, and I hope you don't get freaked out by it. But it wouldn't be fair if we didn't say a couple words. We did this already when we talked about inflammation. But just kind of remember, the mother of all prostaglandins, leukotrienes, thromboxanes, and lipoxanes is a compound called arachidonic acid. It's a long-chain fatty acid. It results from the breakdown of membranes, phospholipids in the cell membrane. And, of course, steroids act at the level of producing arachidonic acid for that inflammatory thing. So steroids inhibit phospholipases, which break down some membranes to become arachidonic acid. That's basically one of the main reasons for steroid inhibition of inflammatory structures. Now, if you have your mother of all compounds here, I'm trying to think of the word, the eicosanoids. These are all eicosanoids. If arachidonic acid is the mother of all eicosanoids, it basically could go into two directions. One of them is in direction of action of 5-lipoxygenase, and the other direction are the cyclooxygenases. Okay, if it goes into cyclooxygenases, it's producing the big class of eicosanoids called prostaglandins and thromboxanes. And these are the things that are the thing that cause it. The prostaglandin, you know, causes vasodilatation. It also inhibits platelet aggregation, we said, with the cyclooxygenase 2 inhibition. On the other end, you have the lipoxygenase giving rise to these families of leukotrienes. But if you go from 5 to 12 lipoxygenase, you create a new family of eicosanoids called the lipoxins. And generally speaking, the lipoxins counteract the effects of the leukotriene. So one of them causes vasoconstriction, the other one causes vasodilatation, one of them causes bronchospasm, the other one causes bronchorelaxation. So basically, if you want to just take this whole nightmare of eicosanoid chemistry, just remember arachidonic acid is the mother. It's come from the cell membrane phospholipids. It either goes into the prostaglandin and thromboxane family or into the leukotrienes and lipoxin family, and the leukotrienes counteract the lipoxins. Okay, that's all I'm going to say. I guess it's a good time to leave the drugs now, the common drugs, and talk a little bit about pollution. And that's probably the first thing you would be talking about when you have a chapter called environmental. And there's no way we could go into the full description of an elucidation of all these. I'm going to say a little thing about radon, but I'm just going to be very brief with some of these other compounds. You know, carbon monoxide, you know, car exhaust fumes, buildups, okay? We all know it's a common way to commit suicide, but lower levels of carbon monoxide, respiratory problems, dizziness, headaches, fatigue. These are very general, non-specific things. What about this big concern also in the atmosphere of NO2, nitrogen dioxide, the chief component of acid rain? Well, NO2, I think I have a little blurb on it here. It also has short-term exposure, could be, cause respiratory problems, some distress or harmful lung function. The more exposure, the more severe the respiratory problem. Wood smoke, okay, not surprising, chronic respiratory function, okay, aggravates asthma, maybe even causes asthma. You know, formaldehyde, boy, this is one that's really big with pathologists because, you know, we've been exposed to it in big terms. Generally, lower levels of formaldehyde. If you go to real pathology labs, you know, not just my virtual lab, but real pathology labs, the first thing you do is maybe your eyes might water a little bit, blurring, watering eyes. It's also listed as a probable carcinogen as well. We talked about the manufactured mineral fibers, you know, the non-biological fibers, the things causing the pneumoconioses, you know, asbestosis, you know, miners. But then there are also the bioaerosol, and it's defined as an aerosol or tiny droplets that contain either portions of living organisms or small living organisms. These are the bioaerosols. The thing that is the most concern for our discussion at this point, we're going to kind of ignore the detailed discussion of the rest of them, is radon. Okay, does radon cause lung cancer? Okay, well, yeah, it has an effect on it, okay, especially in synergy with smoking. But look, for those of you that are nuclear physicists here or rocket scientists, you know that radon, if you look at your uranium, your various uranium isotopes, emitting things like alpha particles and then degrading into lower levels, finally, ultimately, into stable compounds like lead, you know, radon is in that chain. It's a product of uranium, okay? So the radon that's in your basement, you know, at the bottom of your basement, because it's still a very, very heavy gas, is a decay product of uranium. If we had no uranium decay in the world, there wouldn't be any radon. There's a lot in the soil. It generally goes to the lower levels because it's heavy. And not only is it heavy in terms of atomic weight, but the particle that it emits is also very, very heavy. It's not a weightless gamma ray or an X-ray, or it's not a tiny beta particle or positron. It's the heaviest of all radioactive emission particles. It's an alpha emitters, you know, two protons, two neutrons. It doesn't penetrate very far. I have been told by, you know, very smart physicists that the radon, the alpha particles, are generally stopped by a couple of sheets of paper. But if those are in your lung, because it's a gas, even though it's not traveling very far, it could do some very, very heavy damage because it's a very heavy particle. Okay, so here are the statistics. There's probably, of all those lung cancers that we talked about every year, probably 10,000, if you wanted to do a very general estimate, are probably due to radon. Now, if that person that gets the lung cancer from radon is also a smoker, then that elevates their risk tremendously. And that's probably no big surprise, because smoking weakens the lung for all types of inflammatory and neoplastic processes as well. Well, you know, you can buy a radon detector and measure your radon, and you know, the government will measure radon in soil before, you know, people are considering building in a certain lot. You know, they did this in North Chicago here at a place that's going to be having a big shopping center. They found that the radon levels were high. Well, proper ventilation reduces the exposure, because it still is a gas, although it's a heavy gas. If you're blowing that basement air out, that would be basically the solution. Of course, if you are living in a house and your heating bills are high, you want to keep everything insulated, you know, you're not going to be, you know, blowing air out of your basement very much. Big thing is lead, also a heavy metal, also in the list of toxic compounds like mercury, arsenic, cadmium, all heavy metals. The personal exposures to lead are basically two types. If you have a household exposure, the primary route is oral ingestion. If you have an industrial exposure, and you could have lead in your air, and there could be an inhalation phenomenon. So what are the sources? Well, lead paint, you know, which they've largely gotten away from, soldering, you know, the older houses still have lead in their pipes. They're not into the plastics anymore. Lead-glazed ceramics. And of course, these are would be considered household exposures unless you're in the glazing ceramic industry. And of course, the industrial exposure is strictly going to be, you know, through the lungs. The body thinks that lead is calcium. Okay, it's a big heavy metal like calcium. It's a divalent cation. It's stable, it's not radioactive, but even though it's stable and it doesn't have a radioactive half-life, it still has a biologic half-life. So of all the lead that's in your bones right now, or your children's bones, you know, because your body thinks it's calcium, so it puts it into hydroxyapatite, half of that is still going to be there 30 years later. Okay, so it has a biological half-life. Now, you can measure lead levels in the blood, but they don't have any correlation whatsoever into the amount of lead that's being stored in your body, whether it's soft tissues, whether it's in bone. So blood lead levels don't have any indication of your total body lead burden. They could have errors both ways. Theoretically, lead should be excreted by the kidneys, but an overabundance of exposure will exceed the body's ability to excrete it, and that's why we're going to have clinical effects and problems. And the main, or some of the main biochemical reasons for those problems are the fact that lead, chemically, has a very, very high affinity for sulfhydryl groups. Now, in heme biosynthesis, lead interferes with those sulfhydryl groups, and you can get in the red cells defective heme, which is characterized by this concept of basophilic stippling. You see this normal red cell here, this normal red cell here. Well, some of these red cells have little blue stippling on them, and that's a classical feature of lead toxicity, is basophilic stippling of the erythrocytes. Now remember, lead fooling the body into thinking it's calcium. is also put into the bone. So you can see some of those lead lines in the bone radiologically. They result of increased densities in the epiphyses of the bone. And also, lead inhibits certain enzymes. If you remember, we talked about 5' nucleotidase as being a membrane-bound enzyme. Inhibiting this enzyme results in damage to the enzyme. You now have your some damage in your sodium-potassium pump. There's leakage, and that cell can die, okay? If you're talking about the membranes of the red cells, those size die earlier than they should as well. What's that called? That's called hemolysis. It could damage renal cells, resulting in hypertension. Let's have a little diagram here. If you want to think of it this way, lead can be toxic to the brain. We talked about basophilic stippling in the blood. We talked about kidney damage. We talked about the epiphyses of bones, especially growing bones, which are taking up calcium and disguised lead as well. And then if you want to also, just as though the radiologist will talk about lead lines in the bone, you know, the ENT guys might talk about lead lines in the gingiva. One is a radiologic line, and the other is actually a pigmentary thing. We're going to take a look at that as well. Has effect on peripheral nerves. You could have neuropathies due to lead. And, of course, badly damaged children that have had lead exposure, you know, people eating lead that are in paint, have severe general retardation as well. So it affects a lot of things. And remember, and if you're a occupational, you might be working in the industries where there are lead, like battery burning, foundry work, spray painting where they're using lead. Whereas if you're just a occupational exposure, you might get it from the lead in the pipes or house dust, newsprint, automotive exhaust, where we previously had lead in fuel, now largely taking out because of those reasons. Here's some basophilic stippling. We saw this before. Here's one that's a little more subtly basophilic stippled, somebody with lead intoxication. Here is an epiphyses in the knee, both here and here. You would call these lead lines. They're increased densities in the metaphysis of the bone. Okay, if I said epiphyses, I think I was wrong, because this is generally the metaphysis that shows the increased density. So a radiologist might call this a lead line. And of course, if you take a look at that little line there in the gingiva, at the general junction between the tooth and the gingiva, that pigmented area is also called a lead line as well, and due to lead intoxication. What's this person? Well, his wrist is dropped. Is that radial nerve palsy? Of course it is. So there's an example of a neuropathy due to lead poisoning. And here's an abdominal, regular old flat plate of a child. And you can see little particles in the GI system. Now, that doesn't mean they're lead, but it means that there's something there in the GI system that's high density. So one of the classic reasons for, especially in children that lived in homes where they were picking and eating paint, you know, kids like to put everything in their mouth. The disease which causes them to do that is called pica. I don't know why it's called pica, but it's not the type of thing that you see, which is a typewriter font. There's also pica is also a genus of magpie, a city in Chile. Pica is a medical disease. It's an order characterized by an appetite, often in, you know, pathologic appetite, for non-food, non-nutritive substances. Kids are eating clay, coal, soil, feces, chalk. Also occurring a lot in, you know, people with severe mental problems as well. So that's pica. It doesn't mean it's lead, but it was pieces of paint. There could be lead in there, couldn't there? Okay, I think that we're done with lead. And I'm going to look at the clock, and it's a lot later than I thought. And I was hoping to go through radiation because a lot of my publications have been in radiation, and I consider myself a big expert on it. But I'll save that for next class, which will be in 5 days. And here we are, slide 47 out of 77. We'll definitely finish this. And, you know, we're talking about control and loss of control before. I would like to think I can control exactly when this course will be over. And if you gave me my best estimate, I would say, well, we're going to have one more session on environmental nutritional, and then we're going to have two sessions on pediatrics, and then the last session will be our graduation ceremony that you're all going to come to, and we'll have Dr. Kumar give the speech at. Well, it doesn't always work that way, not just in alcoholics, but in regular people, non-alcoholics. They always think they get control more than they can. So my best guess would be that this course will be over in four more sessions. But you want to know something? Every time I've done that, I've been wrong and something comes up. The one thing that we're not going to do is the chapter on eye. So if you want to learn about eye pathology, the last thing you want to do is listen to me, because my son is a world-famous ophthalmologist, and he has a movie that's been on my website now for a couple years. So I would never, ever try to pretend like I know much about ocular pathology, because there's no way I could ever be as good as my son's movie. So if you feel the need to complete this course and do that final chapter of Robbins for eye, you know, watching my son's movie on my website would be much better than listening to me. I don't do eye. I would love to. But we'll start out doing radiation next week in 5 days minus 2 hours. And this is now Thursday at 11 exactly. It's my happiest time of the day. Except for my bad foot, I would normally do major hiking this weekend, but I'll probably have to find another way to have fun. Okay, we're done for today. Thanks for hanging in there. I do have a final song, which is a very, very, very beautiful song. And if you were there at the beginning, you would see I also found the lyrics to it while I was playing around. It's a beautiful, beautiful love song by Linda Ronstadt called All My Life. Rock on, you buzzards. Thank you. life for you. Now you're here. Hey, I've spent all of my life rock on, you buzzards.